Today, buckle up, the market's just got interesting. Hello again, it's Martin North from Digital Finance Analytics. Welcome to this post covering finance and property news. Well, markets are clearly confused. The S&P 500 closed sharply lower on Wednesday, suffering its biggest one-day loss since 2022, as tech stocks nosedived following underwhelming second quarter earnings from heavyweights Alphabet and Tesla. After the recent political machinations in America with Trump in the ascendancy, followed by the switch from Biden to Harris, the Trump trade got reversed, and in big tech, the rotation from AI stocks continued, with players like Google reportedly spending much more on Capex than expected, investing in AI, without a clear uptick in revenue, while Tesla pushed out some of their new business plans and reporting weaker sales revenue. And then we got the prospect of US rate cuts now emerging in September, having at the start of the year priced in up to 6 cuts. A month ago, markets considered a rise in rates as inflation appeared more sticky. But now the economic cracks may suggest a series of cuts and soon. And in China, data continues to be weak after the recent conflab that did little to clarify government support for the weak economy, with speculation rising that they will wait for the US election results before doing much more. And while rate cuts continued in Canada yesterday and are expected in Europe and the UK, it appears rate rises are more likely in Japan and in Australia. And finally, we have the normal summer thinner volumes, and then the prospect of the typically wobbly markets that we often see in September and October before a run-up towards the end of the year. So it's all to play for. Traders are going very, very cautious and taking money off the table and into safe havens, switching from the high-tech sector bets and watching for the next moves. That said, geopolitical tensions present the biggest risk to markets due to escalating tensions in the Middle East and the persisting conflict between Russia and Ukraine, according to Jefferies. They say that the risks, combined with surging global spending on weapons, are fundamentally inflationary, especially in a G7 world where the line between monetary and fiscal policy has been blurred due to central banks holding substantial portions of their own government bonds. Despite these challenges, though, Jefferies maintains a positive outlook for equities and credit markets for the second half of the year. Well, we'll see about that. So as a result of all this, on Thursday, Asian shares were hammered as a slumping in the global tech stock sent investors fleeing into less risky assets, including short-dated bonds, the yen, and the Swiss franc. Chinese stocks, iron ore, and oil prices dropped further after the country's central bank sprang a surprise cut in long-term interest rates that only stoked further worries about the world's second largest economy. European markets opened lower, with the Stock 600 down 1.5%, while the FTSE slipped more than 1% in early trade. The sell-off in stocks saw investors ramping up bets on rate cuts globally, with futures implying a 100% chance of a Federal Reserve easing in September. A spike in market volatility fueled a vicious squeeze on carry trades, which saw the US dollar sink another 0.7% to 152.29 yen on Thursday. MSCI's broadest index of Asia-Pacific shares outside Japan lost 1%, while Japan's Nikkei tumbled 3.3%, exacerbated by an 11% plunge in Nissan Motor after its quarterly profit slumped a massive 99%. Taiwan's markets were closed for a second day due to a typhoon, but Korea's KOSPI fell 1.73% after chipmaker SK Hynix fell 8.87% despite clocking a stronger than expected profit in the second quarter, boosted chiefly by higher revenues as the rapidly growing AI industry ramped up demand for advanced memory chips. The firm posted an operating profit of 5.47 trillion won, or $4 billion, in the 3 months to June the 30th, compared to a loss of 2.88 trillion won last year. This came on the back of revenue reaching a record high of 16.42 trillion won in the quarter, more than doubling from the same period last year. Chinese blue chips slid 0.9%, with the Shanghai Composite Index falling 0.9%. to a five-year low, And the CSI 300 also fell substantially. Hong Kong's Hang Seng plunged 1.7%, finding little support from Beijing's latest easing step. On Wall Street, the Nasdaq lost close to 4%. That's the worst one-day fall since 2022, as lackluster Alphabet and Tesla earnings undermined investor confidence in the already lofty valuations of the Magnificent Seven stocks. Google parent Alphabet fell nearly 5%, even as its second quarter earnings beat expectations on increased advertising sales and strong demand for its cloud services, but a massive increase in Capex on AI. Tesla stocks tumbled 12% after its second quarter earnings missed estimates amid falling vehicle sales. Tesla's profit margin fell to a five-year low as the electric vehicle maker aggressively cut prices to grapple with increased competition in key markets such as China. All of that added to recent market volatility, with Wall Street's fear gauge jumping to a three-month high. Investors looked for the safety of cash and super liquid short-term debt, with US two-year yields hitting their lowest in almost 6 months on Wednesday. Traders have played outright defense as the saturated and well-owned tech position continues to be unwound, said Chris Weston, head of research at Pepperstone. We can also add an ongoing unease around China's growth trajectory, very poor PMIs in Europe, and a bearish option piece from ex-New York Fed member Bill Dudley, and investors and traders de-risked and degrossed portfolios. The other big move in Asia was the safe haven yen up 0.7% to the strongest level in 2.5 months. It surged 1.1% overnight, with the upper momentum intact ahead of the Bank of Japan's meeting next week, where policymakers will debate whether or not to raise interest rates. The Swiss franc also rose 0.3% to 0.8803 per dollar, having gained 0.7% overnight. And short-dated bonds rallied, supported comments from that former New York Fed President Dudley that the central bank should cut rates, preferably at its policy meeting next week. The yield on the two-year treasury fell further to 4.367%, while the 10-year was at 4.239%. Markets are fully pricing in a quarter point rate cut from the Fed in September, with even some risk of a 50 basis point cut. But for all of 2024, the total easing of 65 basis points now has been priced in. The rate cut expectations are getting very elevated, the same way they were last year, said Andrew Lilly, chief rate strategist at Barrenjoey in Sydney. My worry is that the market is getting ahead of the economic data because we have seen previously that these short-term dips in inflation haven't been sustained. Initially, advanced US gross domestic product data is due out later on Thursday and is forecast to slow growth picking up to an annualized 2% in the second quarter. And the closely watched Atlanta Fed GDP Now indicator points to growth of 2.6%, indicating some risk to the upside. In commodity markets, iron ore prices fell almost 1% as China concerns weighed, while oil prices were pinned near six-week lows. Brent futures fell to $81.08 a barrel, while US West Texas Intermediate also dropped to $76.97. And even gold fell 1% to $2,375 an ounce on the futures contract. And turning to the Australian share market, it tumbled as well, its most in 6 weeks actually, led by a sell-off in the tech sector and as weaker commodity prices extended a tough month for mining companies. On the day, the ASX 200 dropped 1.3% to 7,861 points. That's the worst day since June the 11th and the lowest close since July the 10th, as all 11 sectors finished in the red. The tech sector was the hardest hit, falling 2.9% as traders took profits and worried over the inflated valuations of the US mega cap tech stocks. Block owner Afterpay fell 6.7% to $93.98, while cloud accounting business Xero dropped 3.5% to $131.10, and software logistics group WiseTech retreated 3.2% to $90.02. The materials sector tumbled another 1.6% and is now down 4.1% in 5 days as copper, oil, gas, gold and silver all extended losses over the session. And that hit the Aussie dollar, which lost another 0.6% to 65.34 US cents, the lowest level since May the 1st. The domestic factors working against Australian shares are that earnings are relatively mooted compared to globally, and the Reserve Bank is still the only central bank contemplating rate rises apart from Japan, said David Bassanese, the chief economist at BetaShares. US earnings growth expectations are 10 to 12%, but in Australia it's only around 5% as the energy and resources sector are going to drag. Mining giant Fortescue Metals lost 5.5% to $20.14 after it used its June quarter production report to flag that the cost of mining iron ore in Western Australia could rise by almost 10% in the next year. The iron ore major's value has now fallen in 7 of the past 8 trading sessions. BHP lost 0.9% to $41.19, and Rio Tinto dropped 1.4% to $112.81. The gold miners were actually the only bright spot in the market, with Newmont finishing at 1.7% to $72.30. In corporate news, investment bank Macquarie said a weak quarter for its investment banking division dragged down earnings in an otherwise flat result. We think the update reads worse than the market expected, with the implied net profit performance down on a prior corresponding period, said UBS. Macquarie's shares finished down 3.4% to $201.61. ANZ also updated the market on the investigations in its Sydney dealing room relating to a transaction from 2023 bond trading. Its shares lost 0.6% to $29.32 as the broader financial sector dominated by the big four banks lost 0.8%. The CEO, Elliott, said that the corporate regulator had recognised the investigation into ANZ's role in last April's $14 billion bond sale is at its early stages. And it updated the share market on Thursday about the escalating crisis in its markets division. The bank laid out where it stood on the three-pronged controversy that covers alleged market manipulation, misreporting, and the re-emergence of a toxic culture in its trading desk. But the most significant aspect of this statement was the clear shift in ANZ's mindset. This is no longer a scandal that requires containment, but an enormous liability, personally and financial, that needs to be managed. ANZ Chief Executive Shane Elliott said that the board had taken ownership of the processes to ensure consequences would be applied to senior executives, both past and present, including myself, where appropriate. That's a clear indication that investigations into whether traders may have had a hand in pushing up the government's borrowing costs and provide its debt management agency with inflated numbers will have to go to the top. The scandal is also unusual because it is playing out in the public domain. A serious investigation typically takes place in secret, but this time the broad facts are well known. This puts more pressure on ANZ, its management and its board, but also the regulator, upping the stakes even further for all involved to get to the right outcome. And jobs marketplace SEEK lost 1.7% to $20.20 after it wrote down the value of its Chinese marketplace by $141 million in an outcome it blamed on China's weak economy. And finally, Bitcoin also dropped, aping the broader market. It's ending a downturn seen through this week as a broader risk-off sentiment kept traders wary of cryptocurrencies, while continued speculation over the US presidential election also weighed in. It was last at 64,388. And world number two token Ether also saw extended losses as traders largely looked past the launch of spot exchange traded funds in US markets this week. The launch attracted a fraction of capital flows in comparison to those seen by spot Bitcoin ETFs earlier in the year, and it was last at 3,176.20. And given Harris's past as a public prosecutor who had cracked down on banks and for-profit colleges, it appears likely that she would continue Biden's agenda of stricter financial regulation in the country, which bodes poorly for crypto ahead. So standing back, you can see a certain amount of chaos here. Expect considerable volatility over the next few days. I expect a rebound today and tomorrow, but more downside ahead as the rotation out of big tech continues and as the continued political uncertainty boils on. Plenty to play for, plenty to watch, but I think safely from the sidelines at the moment. Now, if you're buying your home in Sydney's contentious market, you don't need to stand alone. This is the time you need to have Edwin Almeida from Ribbon Property Consultants standing alongside you. Buying a property is both challenging and adversarial. The vendor has a professional on their side. Emotions run high, price discovery and price transparency are hard to find, and then there's the wasted time and financial investments that you make. Edwin understands your needs, so why not engage a licensed professional to stand alongside you? With RPC, you know you have experience, knowledge, and master negotiators looking after your best interests. So shoot Ribbon an email at info@ribbonproperty.com.au. And if you use the promo code DFAWTW/Martin, you can get a 10% discount offer. I'm Martin North from Digital Finance Analytics. Many thanks for watching, and I'll see you again next time.